Hello, I'm Reverend Jonathan Watson, pastor of Cape Fear Presbyterian Church. On behalf of her family, I want to thank you for gathering virtually to celebrate the life of Kitty Margot King Richardson and witness to the joy of the resurrection. As Jesus Christ reminded his followers, "I am the resurrection and the life," says the Lord. "Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." Let us pray. Merciful God, you heal the broken in heart and bind up the wounds of the afflicted. Strengthen us in our weakness, calm our troubled spirits, and dispel our doubts and fears. In Christ's rising from the dead, you conquered death and opened the gates to everlasting life. Renew our trust in you, that by the power of your love, we shall one day be brought together again with our sister. Grant this, we pray, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear these words from Holy Scripture, beginning with the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. From Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time on and forevermore. From the book of Revelation. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." And from the Gospel of John. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas, one of Jesus' followers, said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. I have said these things to you while I am still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid.
Miss Kitty may not be here in the flesh, but her legacy will continue. I truly believe that if she could share her wishes with us today, it would be that we make sure we check on Regina and Neil, and that we continue her legacy. On November 15th, 2 months before Miss Kitty left this earth, she posted on Facebook something I think speaks to Miss Kitty. She said, "We are now 8 months into this. If you are not working, not getting a paycheck, struggling to make ends meet and run out of food or necessities, please don't let yourself or your kids go to sleep with an empty stomach. Don't be afraid or embarrassed to send me a private message. I am more than happy to help. I will drop and go or order for delivery. No one has to know, and I will pretend it never happened." What's understood never has to be explained. I don't have a lot, but the little I have, I am willing to share. We are all in this together. It's interesting that she posted that just 2 months before she passed, because it clearly speaks to her legacy. And I truly believe that that is what she would want us to do, to continue her legacy. She was a beautiful person, a beautiful soul, and I feel so blessed to have known her. The last time I saw Miss Kitty, we ran into each other in the parking lot of Harris Teeter, and I wasn't really having such a good day. I was pretty down that day, and I remember we stood in the parking lot and we talked for a while, and before the conversation was over, she made me feel so much better, and what I was down about, she just made me feel like I was much bigger than what had me down, and I will never forget her for that. That's who she was. She loved her family, her friends, and strangers alike, and would do anything in this world to make them happy. You know, one of the last text messages that I received from Miss Kitty was one night after watching the news, she sent me this text, and she said, "Your hair and outfit looks great. I especially like your hair." I don't know if she knows what that meant to me, but it made me feel so good that day. And I think that is what she would want. She would say to the ladies who are watching, "Honey, wear your bling, make sure your nails are done, and put on some lip color. And feel pretty, even if no one else thinks you are." That was Miss Kitty. I loved her. I will continue to love her. And I will feel her spirit, as I'm sure many of you will, when you need it most. We will look out for you, Regina and Neil, and the rest of her family, as I know this is a very difficult time. But heaven is a much better place now. Yes, it is. She is blinging, and she is making people in heaven feel good. That's who she was. We love you, Miss Kitty, and we will miss you always.
When I get where I'm going, on the far side of the sky, the first thing that I'm gonna do is spread my wings and fly. I'm gonna land beside the lion and run my fingers through his mane. Or I might find out what it's like to ride a drop of rain. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will share the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. I'm gonna walk with my granddaddy, and he'll match me step for step. And I'll tell him how I missed him every minute since he left. And then I'll hug him. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will share the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fears. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. So much pain and so much darkness in this world we stumble through. All these questions I can't answer, There's so much work to do. When I get where I'm going and I see my Maker's face, I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, oh, when I get where I'm going,
my Christian friends, Jesus Christ understood perhaps more than anyone else that living entails loss. It entails watching the person and things which we cherish slip away. But at the same time, living also provides an extraordinary stage for us to act out our love for one another. There is no love without compassion. There is no compassion without sacrifice. There are times, my Christian friends, when we wish against reason, we hope against hope that a long weekend, a friendship, a loving bond, or a steady heartbeat would never run its course. And yet the simple truth is that they all run their courses. Loss is as predictable as it is uncertain. It is as logical as a mathematical equation and as arbitrary as a lightning strike. Whenever we suffer loss in our lives, if only for a moment or if only forever, our lives are disrupted, our lives are changed. Loss destroys the myth of invulnerability and forces us to reckon with the truth that we are all vulnerable. Our salvation lies not in denying the inevitability of loss, but learning how to fold loss into our lives, learning how to mourn, and perhaps more importantly, how to redeem our mourning. When we escape suffering, it is not because of God's mercy, just as when we walk through suffering, it is because of God's malevolence. God does not engineer suffering and loss. Rather, God calls us to redeem suffering, to die into love. To die into love, what does that mean? To die into love is to have compassion. There is no love without compassion. There is no compassion without sacrifice. To die into love is to redeem inevitable loss. It is lighting a candle instead of cursing the darkness. It is to make something out of our mourning and to create minor resurrections from life's crosses. Kitty Richardson graciously introduced me to my wife. The life of Kitty Richardson is just such a person in my life. She is part of my understanding of a minor resurrection in a life of crucifixions. her life is a life of compassion, of sacrifice, of lighting a candle for our darkness. Hers is a life of minor resurrections in life's crosses. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted, Jesus says in the Beatitudes, in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, verse 4. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. We cannot know how to comfort another unless we have first learned how to mourn. We cannot heal another without first understanding what it feels like to be wounded and broken. The offer of comfort from someone who has not mourned lacks authenticity. The corollary, then, of mourning is empathy. Empathy, my Christian friends, is a risk. Anytime we show empathy, it is a risk, which is why we shy away from it. It is risky because when we extend ourselves to a person who is in pain, we are allowing their condition to remind us of our own condition, to remind us that what they bear in the human condition is inevitably what we bear also. Why then, my Christian friends, do we even bother offering empathy? Why do we look after one another's suffering, one another in pain, if all it does is remind us of our own? We do it because by another's suffering, we are compelled to do what we are inclined to ignore. It's exactly what the Easter story is about the resurrection. If mourning is Good Friday, then comfort and empathy is Easter Sunday. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted, Matthew 5, 4. Today, my Christian friends, we mourn Kitty Richardson. Today, we are comforted by Kitty Richardson. Blessed are those who mourn, they shall be comforted. Christ's mourning, Christ's empathy, Christ's death, Christ's resurrection has made this so.
Somewhere beyond the grave, there is a land where Jesus went to prepare by his own hand, and for the saved by grace, there is a resting place, and in a few more days, it will be mine. Some call it heaven, I call it home. Some call it dreaming, well, let me dream on. Some call it paradise, somewhere beyond the sky. Some call it heaven, I call it home. Someone said you can go back home again. Things will not ever be as good as they've been. Well, I've got good news for you. When heaven comes into view, One glimpse and you'll know the best is yet to come. Some call it heaven, I call it home. Some call it dreaming, well let me dream on. Some call it
You know, we're here to celebrate the life of Miss Kitty. You know, everyone doesn't get the right name, but Miss Kitty, she had the right name. I mean, who gets the name Miss Kitty but Miss Kitty? You know, the thing I loved about her is the fact that she loved her family. She truly loved her daughter and her son-in-law. She loved her church and she loved her community. She loved serving the seniors here. She loved booking travel trips and seeing the country as well. And truly, I know that she also loved me. We had several conversations throughout the years, and every time she would see me, she would have that warm, affectionate smile that let me know that I was cared for by her, if nobody else. So she is someone that I would truly miss in this community, and she left an indelible footprint throughout the entire region here, but especially out of the county and our Senior Resource Center. Miss Kitty, now you're with your father in that mansion that he prepared for you a long time ago. You're now in your glorified body, and you can ask all the questions you want to ask of the Father. May God bless you, and just know that we miss you.
Just walls and bright golden avenues. There are primarily two words in the Greek New Testament that speak of servitude. The first one is the word doulos, which is traditionally translated as slave. When Paul speaks of Jesus, he says he emptied himself, taking the form of a doulos, of a slave, that he might come and be with us. The other word is diakonos, from which the word deacon is derived. And diakonos is different from doulos. Doulos speaks about the caste system and about a relationship between master and slave and how that was formally defined. One, for instance, might be indebted and be an indentured servant. One might be a hereditary servant, and then you would be described as doulos. And when you talk about someone being diakonos, that refers simply to the humble tasks of serving in which they engaged. And at one point in time, Paul uses diakonos, and he refers to himself not as a great apostle and not as a great teacher, but says simply, "I am diakonos." Miss Kitty, we miss you at Methodist Home for Children, for you have indeed been diakonos and one who served us. Now, I know at Cape Fear Presbyterian, the order of deacon is a formal order and something that is bestowed upon you by the congregation. And I have no idea whether you were deacon or elder or simply a member of the congregation at Cape Fear Pres, but I know at Methodist Home for Children, we all considered you to be one of those who really served us so beautifully. And all the ways that Miss Kitty served us cannot be listed or enumerated, certainly not in one worship service and not in one brief thank you. When Miss Kitty came, and she came all the time to our events, whether it was foster parent appreciation banquets, whether it would be a foster family Christmas party, whether it would be our Epicurean evening, which was really the brainchild of Regina, and I'm sure Miss Kitty to some extent, when she came, she served. And what she did was radiate goodwill and charm. She learned names and year in and year out, acted as a greeter. And that beautiful, wonderful spirit that she had just simply overflowed from her and into the hearts and lives of everyone who was there in the room. If I were not going to call her diakonos, perhaps I would call her ambassador, for she acted the same way when we were not having events, that as she went through the community, she continued to serve us in the form of an ambassador and would solicit donations and ask people to get enthusiastic and to become informed about who we were at Methodist Home for Children. Miss Kitty, we thank you, and we are grateful for the fact that you have loved Jesus's last, his lost, and his least, and that the children who are the neediest are the ones to whom your heart was extended most quickly and most fully and most completely. God bless you. And I'm sure now that you are on the other side of the River Jordan and living in fullness and glory, that you've already learned the first names of everyone who's in heaven and that you are greeting them regularly and bringing them as much joy as you have brought us through the ages. And in many ways, you have excelled all of us here in this life. And you have excelled again, outrunning us. And we look forward to the day when we're able to be reunited face to face. God bless you, Miss Kitty. Rest well. Amen.
Your old hometown looks the same as I step down from the train. There to meet me is my mama and my papa. Down the road I look and there runs Mary, hair of gold and lips like cherries. It's good to touch the green, green grass of home. Yes, they're all arms reaching, smiling sweetly. It's good to touch the green, green grass of home. Your house is still standing, though the paint is cracked and dry. There's that old oak tree that I used to play on. Down the lane I'd walk with my sweet Mary, hair with golden lips like cherries. It's good to touch the green, green grass of home. Yes, they'll all reaching, smiling sweetly. It's good to touch the green, green grass of home. Then I wake and look around me at four gray walls that surround me. And I realize, yes, I was only dreaming. Oh, there's a garden, there's a sad old padre. Arm in arm we'll walk at daybreak. And again, I'll touch the green, green grass of home. Yes, they'll all come to see me in the shade of that old oak tree as they lay me. Eat the green, green grass of home.
That sounds like home.
hear again these words from Scripture, from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 8, verses 14 through 23 and 31 through 39. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If, in fact, we suffer with Him so that we may also be glorified with Him. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold His own Son, but gave Him up for all of us, will He not with Him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Thank you to those who have spoken so fondly of Kitty Richardson, as well as to her niece and nephew and the family friend who provided the beautiful music. You've heard these wonderful remembrances and seen the images that serve to provide a fuller picture of who Kitty was. I was her pastor for the last 15 years, a small drop in the bucket in her over 50-year membership in the Cape Fear Presbyterian congregation. As you might imagine, Kitty was an active church member, along with her family, including her late husband, O'Neill, joining in all manner of worship and fellowship activities. Additionally, she held a number of leadership roles over the years, including as a Sunday school teacher, serving on three pastor search committees, and as a ruling elder, assisting in various areas of ministry during her several terms on the session, our local church council. This week, I heard her children, Regina and Neil, affectionately recall how Kitty was full of life and always ready for the next adventure. And adventure was not just a state of mind. She was the heart and soul of the family business, Rich Tours Travel. Their motto was, "Let us take you where you want to go." And for over 30 years and hundreds of trips, Kitty and her family did just that, helping people discover local treasures and faraway places. Kitty reveled in the public role of hostess and behind-the-scenes business manager. You've heard others comment about Kitty's thoughtfulness, caring, and her willingness to help those in need. Regina shared that she loved to help homebound church members and neighbors refill their medications, pay bills, get their mail, and share a meal, whatever was needed. And there are many other stories like this. Having such wonderful memories of a loved one makes it difficult to say goodbye. It's natural to grieve the loss of one who obviously meant so much to so many. But as Jesus told his disciples in the passage from John that we heard earlier, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." And the reason why our Christian hearts are not troubled is because of Jesus' promise of eternal life. Kitty has preceded us to an eternal presence in God's love, perhaps her greatest adventure. Turning to the passage from the Apostle Paul's letter to the Christ followers living in Rome that I read earlier, one thing that comes through loud and clear is that God is for us. That's astounding news. Despite all the evidence to the contrary here on earth, God was for us in the very beginnings of creation, and the Lord is for us still. And if God is for us, who indeed can be against us? Paul's witness was revolutionary. God's answer to us, to all our secret but unmet hopes, to all our longings for a better way, to all of creation, is yes. To all the forces of the world that shout no, and they are not to be discounted, Paul holds up the triumphant yes of God, embodied in Jesus Christ, crucified and raised from the dead. The yes of God pursues his children with abandon. God's answer to our questions about life are answered, yes. Does life have meaning? Yes. Can meaning be found even in death? Yes. Yes is spoken to us in baptism before we even have an opportunity to say no. God chooses us long before we have a voice in the matter. That's how far back the history of his love for us stretches. And yes is spoken here, even in this virtual memorial for a departed loved one. God's love for us embraces all of life, even the death that concludes each life. Paul's triumphant witness is that the yes of God in Jesus Christ is so powerful that there's nothing in heaven or on earth that can separate us from it. No illness, not even COVID-19. No death, no tears, no grave. Paul speaks with understanding, having been to the desperate bottom of things. And from his experience, we learn that even the most desperate, most catastrophic circumstances cannot separate us from God's love. Through her faith in Jesus, Kitty now has entered that place where there's no more illness or crying, pain or dying. We can be thankful that her life didn't truly end when her body failed. Instead, it continues in the house of her heavenly Father. Because of her faith, in the words of the psalmist, Kitty is now dwelling in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Let us pray. O God, before whom generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all your servants, who having lived this life in faith, now live eternally with you. Especially we thank you for your servant Kitty, whose baptism is now complete in death. We praise you for the gift of her life, for all in her that was good and kind and faithful, for the grace you gave her that kindled in her the love of your dear name and enabled her to serve you faithfully. We thank you that for her death is past and pain ended, and that she has now entered the joy you have prepared through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you always. Amen.